question. You recently went on a trip to Indonesia, and you just came back. How long did that trip last?
It was a rather short trip. I had only planned on seeing John and then going over to see another gentleman, Lawrence Blair, that lives in Bali. And it was just kind of like a business trip, so it didn't. I wasn't planning on anything, you know, that would be fun. It was just all business.
Okay.
So it was a short trip. It lasted, let's see, what, 7 days, 8 days.
Okay. Lawrence Blair is the same gentleman from the documentary, correct?
Yes.
Okay. How is he doing?
Oh, he's doing great. He shared with me that he was currently involved in working out this something with producers on a new movie, in fact, that his brother had written a number of years ago, and I looked at the script, and it was pretty interesting.
Okay, so this would not be a documentary, or would this be a actual cinema movie, like a...
It would be a cinematic movie.
Normal script, plot, characters, okay?
Yes.
Okay, nothing more about Mo Pai, or the same subject matter, or don't you know?
Are you talking about discussing the Mo Pai with Lawrence?
Yeah.
Not really. He just wanted to know how John was doing. He hasn't had much contact with him for some time. However, he is in contact a little more often with one of John's closest friends, who happens to become a close friend of Lawrence's. So he wanted to know how, or if I had seen him, and I hadn't.
Can you describe, give the lowdown on what all happened during this trip, what you experienced?
Okay. It was pretty frustrating. I had been having a little difficulty communicating with my teacher for some time, and there's some background that's really involved as to why this has occurred, but I determined that it would be best to just show up on his doorstep, and that way there wouldn't be any problems with trying to make excuses or anything like that. So I just showed up on his doorstep, or at his front door, and he was sitting there with several other people, and he looked at me really surprised when I was standing by his door was open, and but just to have somebody like that to show up, you know, from the other side of the world, I think can be a little alarming. But he seemed kind of startled, but he got up and greeted me, and his first question it was, "How old are you?" So I'm used to that, because he always says things like that, you know, "Where are you staying?" You know, the first questions out of his mouth when I see him are funny things like that. So he caught me off guard a little bit with that, and so I wanted to ease up in my questions that I had. So we sat down and started talking, you know, just passing what had been going on lately and things like that after a period of time that we hadn't seen each other. And then all of a sudden he said, "Excuse me, I have to leave for a minute." So he went and got dressed and came back, and he said, "I have to go to the bank. I'll be back in 10 minutes." And so I said, "Fine, you know, whatever you need to do." And I was anticipating that he would be coming back, but when he goes to the bank, it's kind of a long period of time, so I knew that it would be some time before he came back. So his son had come in and sat down, and we conversed for about an hour. And so John didn't come back, and then his son said that he had some people there that he needed to get back to, and so we left. And then so we called later in the day to see when he would be available, and his son told me that he had just left with a friend on a business trip, and they wouldn't be back until the following day, which meant that we were going to be in Bali going over to visit with Lawrence, and we were going to be over there for about 3 days. So that was that, and so before I left, I had mentioned that I wanted to see the meditation center that John had built in his backyard, which is an underground center for meditating, and he had built that in 2001, I believe, I'm not sure exactly, and where a lot of some of the unusual things that occurred that had to do with his ancestor spirit. And so I had always been curious, so I went over and saw that. But I was anticipating coming back and getting pictures, and so I didn't take anything because we were kind of ushering out, and so that was that. But as far as pictures, when we came back after visiting Lawrence, John had left again, and he was going to be gone for another 3 days. So that just burned everything. So I was really disappointed with that. So I didn't get really any pictures.
Okay, no footage or anything?
Nope.
Okay. Well, it's just how it goes. Okay. What did you observe with John? Anything going on as far as his practice nowadays? I mean, anything of note with regards to Mo Pai?
He is actually out of it. He is no longer involved with the Mo Pai.
Okay.
However, he is involved only in the aspect of doing some testing, which the person that took over the school is an old student that isn't at the fourth or the third level, and he is unable to do any testing, so he has to rely on John, and so that's the only part that John is involved in. But one of the things of note that really probably doesn't mean too much to anybody else, but I noticed that John seemed overall and relieved. He seemed less stressed than what I had known about him before. So, and I attribute that to his retirement and lack of being involved with the school.
Okay, so what is the reason, or can you go into the reason or reasons why Chang is no longer involved in Mo Pai?
He had admitted Westerners into the school, and that is not something that he was supposed to do. The reason why he did was because the lack of students, and the student that took over the school had left prior to that, and so he was sort of left wondering what he was going to do. And then all of a sudden, one day I showed up on his doorstep, and he thought maybe this could work out. But he was in hot water for doing that, and then removed as head of the Mo Pai.
Okay. Now, was it his ancestor spirit who made that decision then?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell a little about the ancestor spirit of Chang, how that entity figures into this?
Yeah, it's kind of a long story. John's teacher, Lau, had passed away, and John had needed to continue talking with him and didn't realize that he had finally moved on to some other realm, and he kept trying to get a hold of him, and he never would respond. And then his ancestor spirit, the Grand Master, Mei Ying Chin, showed up unexpectedly and told John in no uncertain terms that what he was doing wrong, and reminded him of the things that he had promised and so on. And for whatever reason, I have no idea why, but John continued to ignore that and continued teaching me, as well as accepting a few more Westerners. It's really strange as to why he would do that, but he did, without letting us know, you know, the repercussions that he was facing and so on. So that's what got him to be removed from the head of the school.
Okay. So the trip came and went. There was very little contact with Chang, and then what happened?
And then I had been trying to locate without any luck. Actually, I had talked to probably three of the current Indonesian Mo Pai students via email, and none of them were all too willing to help me with anything, you know, give me answers or whatever. Some were polite, and others were one of them that was kind of rude, but I just assumed they were a little bit jealous because I had reached that level and they had not. And they just, you know, culturally speaking, they probably felt like they're, I don't know, like I'm an outsider or something like that. And so it was difficult getting any information out of them.
Okay. Is this kind of based or rooted in Indonesian culture, that they have limited contact with Westerners or share limited information with Westerners?
Yeah, they're an isolated school. You know, historically speaking, it's always been Chinese. And then John's immediate teacher, Lau, had migrated to Indonesia and tried to, I don't know whether he tried, but he accepted two students. And John claims that he doesn't believe that Lau had any more than that. And I really don't know, other than just what John has told me. So that, so we're kind of limited on that information, that, you know, as far as John letting us know what's going on.
Okay, in previous contacts that you had with Chang, what are some of the more remarkable things that you witnessed from him?
Oh, in terms of his abilities?
Yes.
Oh, well, the list goes on. well, see, the first time, I'll start in order. The first time that I had met John, I was sitting down next to him, and after our initial discussion and asking him if I could be accepted as a student, he said yes, and so I immediately asked him if he would demonstrate his electrical ability on me. And so, which he was only too happy to oblige, and to the delight of the other people in the room. And so he shocked me, and naturally you jump, and everybody laughed in unison. And then the reason why I know specifically, you know, that what ability that he has is authentic was he was sitting next to me, and sometimes, you know, when you talk, you put your hand on their arm to make a point or something like that, and that's what I did. I was making a point, and I just touched his arm a little bit, and immediately I was shocked. And so I know that he wasn't ready for it, and, you know, there wasn't any pre-planned little system that he had set up that some people think that John has. But anyways, it made everybody laugh in the room again, because it's pretty alarming when you get zapped. And then, let's see, that was the end of that. I went home and started training. Then I went back. John had left for 3 years for his own training in Borneo. And then when he came back, this was back in 93, so it's a little foggy as to the sequences of things that he did. One was levitation, where he brought a scale out, and he put that on the floor. He doesn't have full levitation ability, but he has a partial. And when I say that, it's basically because he hasn't reached that level where he trains for that. But inadvertently, from his other training, gives him this ability. But in order to do kind of a 90% levitation, it takes him about a week or so to train to get to that point. But anyways, just a small demonstration he can demonstrate on a scale, where he just stands on it and you can watch the scale weight go down, which he did. And we could clearly see that he, you know, there was nothing around that he put his hands on, but you can see that he uses a method of a type of isometric muscle tension thing, and you can watch the weight go down, which is pretty fantastic to see. And he loses about 80% of his weight or so, depending on how much strength that he puts into the effort. And then, let's see, after that, he came to visit his daughter, which I flew down to California to visit with him. I'm not sure if it was then or the following year when he came back to visit his daughter again after she had her baby. Either one, doesn't matter. He had wanted to show me how he could burn a hole in a cup from a distance, you know, like a laser. He said, he was telling me that it's, the energy is like a laser. And so he burned this plastic cup from a distance, probably about, I'd say, close to 9 or 10 feet. And it was a cropped room. And then he had taken a banana and wanted to show me the strength of the energy, how it could cut through the flesh. But if you have something porous like the skin of the banana, it would pass through it. And so he took a banana and demonstrated, and then he peeled it back and the top part fell off. And it was pretty interesting how, you know, the mechanics or the characteristics of the energy, how it interacts with matter. So that was another example. And then one time we were in the house, and he wanted to show us how he could hold water in a upside-down container where the water wouldn't spill out, being held only by his energy. And then to demonstrate that that there was nothing but energy holding the water, he would take these little wooden matchsticks, and he would put it at the bottom of the water, and the matches would float to the top. So it would demonstrate